Give it a couple of minutes there, Andrew. We're over 100 participants already.
I think that's about you, that one.
I think it might be. But
I think it's me.
I'll leave that one aside for the moment. All right, then. Okay. I think that the initial participants who were waiting are now in the room. Okay. Good evening. Welcome to the 44th Strand Group. I'm the director, John Davis. It's a great pleasure for me personally and for all of us at the Strand Group to welcome once again Lord Adonis, one of our repeat performers over many, many years. When Andrew during the summer tweeted that this year was the 100th anniversary of Roy Jenkins, his birth, and he put out a call if somebody would like to host this, I immediately gave him a text and said, you know, it's something that I think that we would absolutely want to be doing. Why is that? Well, first of all, you know, it's Andrew talking about something of which he knows a great deal and will be of a very serious nature. Secondly, I personally got to interview Roy Jenkins back in 1999 when I was doing my master's thesis on his time as Chancellor. With Peter Hennessy. I was struck at the time and forever after that was, awestruck, I suppose, is the phrase, somebody, you know, with such learning, with such experience, but also with such a great capacity to actually convey all of that. And thirdly, I think that Roy Jenkins, though, you know, passing nearly 20 years ago now, I think that what's interesting is that certainly in my classes, his name crops up quite often, not just when we're actually like teaching the history of the Treasury, for example, where he was Chancellor between 67 and 1970. And by most, not all, but by most commentators, actually is one of the great chancellors since the Second World War, but also for his own historical works. And I, for one, think that, well, I'm sure it's not for one, but I know that not everyone would agree, that I think that Roy Jenkins' Churchill is one of my favourite history books. I think it's a masterclass in the quality of its writing. It's also got incredible insight, but that insight comes from the fact that although it doesn't have like almost any actual primary research itself, what it does is it brings his own experience, not just of being a young man where all the great figures of the time would come through the house, his father's career would bring them to the house in Wales, but also him being Chancellor, him being Home Secretary, him going to the European Commission. It just brings a flavour. And I think that Andrew's perfect to actually give this, not least because he was a great friend, but because I think that Andrew's most recent book on Ernest Bevin has got a similar angle to it. And I'm sure that I'm not the only one who hasn't just bought it for themselves, but has bought it for family members too. Without further ado, with the Roy Jenkins Centenary Lecture, Courage with Wisdom, is our great friend, Lord Adonis. Andrew, you're very welcome.
John, thanks very much indeed. And huge thanks to the Strand Group and King's College London for hosting this event. We're going to begin with Roy in his pomp as Chancellor of the University of Oxford.
Lord Jenkins presents an honorary doctorate to his fellow Oxonian, the American President, Bill Clinton.
In verum excellentissimum, guli aeumum Jefferson Clinton.
Jenkins went to Balliol, where one of his tutors nicknamed him Nature's...
I doubt there was any event in Roy's life that gave him more pleasure than that one. He loved centenaries, They appealed to his love of numerical precision, historical milestones, and anecdote. As Chancellor of the University of Oxford, he was forever speaking at centenaries, bicentenaries, even at the 900th anniversary of the University of Bologna, which he said made that Italian seat of learning a trifle older than the University of Oxford, although he added, with a touch of glee, it had long fallen by the wayside. Beta plus at best, not even beta alpha, let alone Oxford's alpha double minus. Roy scraped a first at Balliol. With us today, he would say that puts him a cut above fellow Balliol alumnus Boris Johnson, although Boris was president of the union, which to his lifelong regret, Roy lost by 5 votes. I dreamt recently of Roy discussing Balliol's 4 prime ministers, Heath, Macmillan, Asquith, and Johnson, over one of our lunches at Brooks's Club. His ethereal verdict went something like, a remarkable Balliol quartet, 3 of them presidents of the union, Asquith, Heath, and Johnson, the 4th Macmillan, like me, only proxime as librarian, but we both ended up as chancellors of the university, which may perhaps to some degree be felt to trump the others. Roy would have enjoyed rating himself on his centenary. He would have noted that he was the last, maybe the last ever, truly United Kingdom politician of the first rank, Welsh, an MP for London, Birmingham and Glasgow, a candidate in Solihull and Warrington. Also that he was last and so far the only British president of the European Commission, maybe the last ever, although he wouldn't be entertaining that defeatist notion in the Elysian Fields. He would be both proud and appalled that he still ranks as the only radically liberal Home Secretary in the 238-year history of that great office of state. I shudder to think what he would have made of Priti Patel, given how bad he thought Michael Howard and Jack Straw were. As for Roy's views on Donald Trump, successor to 7 US presidents he had met and several known well, he would have relished Mary Trump's verdict on her uncle. Even the Borgias supported the arts. On Boris Johnson, we would have debated whether Boris was more incompetent than Lord Rosebery, more self-centered than Lord North, more of a spiv than Lloyd George. He would inevitably have likened Boris to a character in Proust, maybe the sybaritic Baron de Charlus. I earned a serious black mark by once admitting to Roy that I hadn't read Proust. My dear Andrew, not even in English, he asked with a hint of condescension. Roy had read the whole of A la recherche du temps perdu in both English and French. The day after his successful 1969 tax-raising budget as Chancellor, he had a long lunch with the French ambassador's wife, where they discussed whether Charlus was pronounced with or without the S. I can't remember which she told him. My main interest as his biographer was to tease out why he was lunching with that grand lady while in the thick of such pressing public affairs. Therein lies a whole other lecture. The key thing about Roy Jenkins is that while I've met no one more serious in their pleasures, I've also met no one more serious in their politics, and absolutely no one more serious and successful at the liberal politics of creating what he called a civilized society, a society which embraced the whole of Europe. It also included the liberal East Coast of the United States. As his son Charles said at his funeral, Roy thought that Boston was at the mouth of the Rhone. Roy used to say that history belongs to those who make the weather, not to the weather vanes. What inspired me about him as an Oxford student and ever since was the combination of politician and biographer, and how someone who spoke like Roy and was so establishment could also be so genuinely radical. Because for those who think that in politics the art of the possible is narrow and circumscribed, unless you're a populist, just look at Roy Jenkins. The legalization of homosexuality and abortion in 1967, in the teeth of deep public and religious opposition, and well before any other large Western democracy had done either, still ranks as one of the most remarkable acts of modern democratic statecraft. And on Europe, Roy wasn't just a major force for Britain's entry into the European Union. He was in many ways the father of today's single European currency, which in the 1970s when he laid the path towards it as president of the commission, seemed, as one of his officials told me, the nearest thing to pie in the sky since the invention of the pie. Then straight after returning from Brussels, he created the SDP. In its long-run effects, one of the most successful insurgent parties in modern British history, a model, maybe the model, for New Labour under the leadership of his young friend and admirer, Tony Blair. As I got to know Roy well and became a friend, I realised that his extraordinary blend of establishment-itis and radicalism was a personality trait, not just a political standpoint. Indeed, Roy's political genius grew out of his personality. His life in all dimensions was an extraordinary blend of self-assurance, courage and risk, enveloped in claret, Brooks's and the Athenaeum. The Proustian liaison dangereuse of his private life followed a similar pattern to his public life. Shirley Williams, 90 this year, told me of a parliamentary trip they both made to Greece in the 1950s. For some reason, they spent the night on a large yacht. As she came out onto her balcony in the early morning, she was amazed to see Roy, from the high deck above, dive straight into the sea. So we have a division going on in the Lords at the moment. Jim Callaghan told me that he was in awe of Roy standing in the Warrington by-election of 1981. The sheer courage to do that at his age was impressive after his career and with so much humiliation if it went wrong, he told me. It was the same with the books. Who starts writing a 1,000-page biography of Churchill at the age of 78? My last conversation with Roy was on the phone the night before he died. He was very ill after a series of heart operations. We talked about how his next project, a biography of JFK, with whom he had known well, was going. I want to start writing tomorrow, were his last words to me. 8 hours later, his wife Jennifer found him slumped in his chair in his bedroom with Ted Sorensen's Life of JFK open in his lap. A clue as to how Roy thought and worked is how he described the writing of Churchill. It's like climbing Everest. I rarely look at the summit, just at the tracks ahead and what advance can be made each day with a bit of determination and optimism. His writing and reading usually started at 6 a.m. Just before lunch, he would count the precise number of words he'd written and note it on a card, usually between 500 and 1,000 words. There wasn't much writing after lunch. Roy told me he'd only once in his life had sandwiches for lunch, and he vowed never to repeat the experience. Of course, if you're going to try and get up a mountain, it's vital to choose the right one and to know quite a lot about it before setting off. Herein, in my view, lies Roy's especial genius. His boldness was matched by shrewdness. He had a generally good, often brilliant, sense of pace, timing, and proportion. Indeed, he used to tell me that a sense of proportion is the supreme quality in politics and in life. From where did these qualities come? I think they had a lot to do with Roy being literally born and brought up in politics and in the values and principles he held for the rest of his life. His father, Arthur Jenkins, was a complete one-off, and Roy was his only and very precious son. A Labour MP and parliamentary private secretary to Attlee when Roy was growing up in Abersicken in South Wales mining valleys in the 1930s, Arthur was a unique blend of trade union leader, politician, autodidact, and Francophile. Mild-mannered, yet administratively decisive and effective, Secretary of the Miners' Federation of South Wales, maybe the single most important union in the country besides Ernie Bevin's Transport and General Workers Union, alongside being a county and district councillor and then MP for Pontypool from 1935 until his early death as a junior minister in Attlee's government in 1946, 2 years before Roy himself became an MP. Arthur had been jailed for incitement to violence on the picket line in the 1926 general strike, yet he insisted he'd never incited anyone, was ashamed to have gone to jail, and refused to become a folk hero in much the way that the fastidious Roy always refused to play to the gallery in his own day. Leading Labour politicians of the 1930s, including Attlee and Herbert Morrison, were constantly staying with the Jenkinses, and from his early teenage years, he was enveloped in political discussion. Here is Roy's father.
Lord Jenkins, leader Clement Attlee as his parliamentary private secretary. Home movies show that as a schoolboy, Roy Jenkins was used to the leaders of the Labour Party, like Herbert Morrison, seen on the left, visiting the family home. And his father's evident enjoyment of the good life was imbibed by the young Roy Jenkins. The family now had a live-in maid, and Arthur Jenkins was the proud owner of a motor car. As a coal miner, he'd studied in Paris and had developed a wider sense of the world than Roy Jenkins' mother.
He always had this outward-looking view. He rather liked the, provided they were men of public responsibility and relatively liberal views, he rather liked the country gentry society of East Monmouthshire, the people he'd met on the county council. And we quite often used to go and visit them for lunch or tea. And insofar as people think I've got slightly grand, slightly Whiggish tastes, I think they came more from him than they did from my mother.
Slightly grand and slightly Whiggish. Roy gravitated to politics almost as naturally as a Cecil or a Cavendish. He first stood for Parliament at the age of 24 in the 1945 election, got elected at a by-election 3 years later, and fought 15 parliamentary elections in all, more than any political titan of the 20th century, apart from Churchill, who fought 20 elections. Roy was a member or leader of major political institutions for 55 years, almost continuously. But more than that, his entire life was politics, including his youth and the writing of his biographies, all of them of major political figures. Even his affairs were with women married to MPs. Jennifer, his wife, to whom he was nonetheless devoted, was passionate about reformist politics since being a Fabian at Cambridge. The two of them met at a Cambridge Fabian summer school, and Jennifer did as much, if not more, campaigning than Roy in all his parliamentary elections. Roy was born into Europe too. Arthur Jenkins held that Paris was the capital of the world. He read and spoke French passionately and took Roy there when he was 17. They stayed in a modest pension. I simply have to read to you this passage in Roy's memoirs about his youthful month in Paris in the summer of 1938, not just for the wonderful Jenkinsisms, but to conjure his whole worldview. I lived in an encapsulation of Third Republican Paris. Boulevard de Port Royal, where we stayed, was redolent of 17th century Jansenism, but its appearance was firmly 19th century, except for a scattering of black Citroëns, red Renault, and market trucks which rolled along the wide pave, either up the gentle slope to the Carrefour de l'Observatoire and the Montparnasse of the Coupole, and the Dome Cafes a short way beyond, or down to join the Avenue des Gobelins, which debouched into the Rue d'Italie, the hub of the southeastern and mainly working class 13e arrondissement. The Boulevard de Port Royal itself was flanked by oppressive public buildings, which seemed to me to have faintly sinister names like Val de Grasse or the Hôpital Cochin or the Baudeloc Lying in Hospital or the Hospice des Enfants Assistés. La Santé prison was just behind. I hoped I would not end up in any of them. Inside the great wooden door of number 85, a porte cochere led into a not very attractive gravelled garden, around which were several separate and 1930-ish three-storied buildings, one of which was my pension. It was presided over by Madame Vincent, who looked severe and concentrated on accurate French and a Gallic but not luxurious diet at the communal table. My room was basic, but had an adequate cloth-covered writing table, which commanded a good view of the eastern sky in the direction of Germany, I frequently thought, for both that summer and the next one, when I returned to the pension, were dominated by the threat of Hitler and the thought of the Nuremberg rallies taking place a few hundred miles away. I acquired some French, but more knowledge of the topography of Paris to match that of London. I do not remember feeling apprehensive about the approach of Oxford. What I did feel apprehensive about was the approach of war. The point of all this is that by the time Roy went up to Oxford at the age of 18, he had more political and international grounding than most politicians ever acquire. And he never shifted his ground for the rest of his life. However, grounding is one thing, character another. Fast forward 25 years to Harold Wilson's first Labour government in 1964, and a single incident reveals Roy's political character like, as he might have said, a streak of lightning lights up the night sky. Roy started out under Wilson as Minister for Aviation outside the cabinet. In January 1965, 3 months into the government, Wilson offered him promotion to the cabinet as Education Secretary. After a few hours of anguished cogitation, Roy turned it down. Wilson was astonished. So am I. It makes Roy literally the only politician of any party I've ever known to have turned down a first cabinet post. Why did he do it? For two reasons, he told me. First, he didn't have a reformist policy for education. Worse, Labour's policy of abolishing the grammar schools was one he disagreed with, having gone to one himself, and Roy rarely did what he disagreed with, and never on major issues. But secondly, the post he wanted was Home Secretary, where for the previous decade, he'd been working out in his mind a whole liberal reformist agenda, roughly what he went on to do as Home Secretary when he got the job. Roy sensed that Wilson's first Home Secretary, Sir Frank Soskiss, nice but weak and beleaguered, wouldn't survive long. And he told Wilson straight out that the Home Office was the job he wanted if it became vacant, which is precisely what happened 11 months later. Having seen the top of politics myself, I am all the more awestruck by this combination of poise, focus, and bold but well-judged risk-taking. Roy was to show it again and again throughout the remaining 38 years of his life, political, literary, and social. On big political questions, Roy wasn't just bold and confident. To an extraordinary degree, he was right. At least I think so. His last speech in the House of Commons was against the restoration of the death penalty. His last speech in the House of Lords was against the looming Iraq war. The fact that he was Tony Blair's friend didn't lead him to pull any of his punches. This is the beginning and the end of that last Lord's speech, 3 months before his death.
I have a high regard for the Prime Minister. I have been repelled by attempts to portray him as a vacuous man with an artificial smile and no conviction. I'm reminded of similar attempts by a frustrated Wright to suggest that Gladstone was mad, Asquith was corrupt, and Attlee was negligible. My view is that the Prime Minister, so far from lacking conviction, has almost too much, particularly when dealing with the world beyond Britain. He is a little too Manichaean for my perhaps now jaded taste. Seeing things in stark terms of good and evil, black and white, contending with each other, and with a consequent belief that if evil is cast down, good will inevitably follow. I fear I'm more inclined to see the world and the regimes within it in varying shades of gray. And the experience of the past year, not least in Afghanistan, has given more support to that view. The more utopian one, the quick change of regime can make us all live happily ever after. My lords, I'm in favor of courage, who is ever not in the abstract, but not of treating it as a substitute for wisdom.
Yeah.
And that, I fear, we are currently in danger of.
Those final words, almost the last words he uttered in public, "I am in favour of courage, but not as a substitute for wisdom," sum up Roy Jenkins. Courage with wisdom. On the wisdom, I was a regular go-between between Roy and Tony Blair from 1997 until his death in January 2003. Month after month, letter after letter, conversation after conversation, Roy urged Tony to take the plunge and join the Euro, and not, as he argued, to repeat the same mistake as Attlee in 1950 and Eden in 1955, and stay out of the construction of the institutions of Europe, only for Britain to have to join from a position of weakness and isolation later. Tony nearly took his advice, nearly, but not quite. But just imagine Britain and Europe today, if he had taken it and gone into the euro instead of Iraq. Ah, but he never became Labour leader and Prime Minister, so never had to make the fundamental choices needed to win and stay in power, some might say. Indeed, Howard Wilson said roughly that when complaining of Roy's refusal to budge on joining Europe after it became unpopular on the Labour left when Heath applied to join in 1971. Roy himself said in his memoirs, "I may have avoided doing too much stooping, but I also missed conquering," in reference to not becoming Prime Minister. However, it's not a criticism of Roy Jenkins that he preached but did not practice, or that he ducked difficult choices, or that he was deficient in accumulating political power. On the contrary, it was his capacity for turning liberal ideas into successful liberal action on the great questions of the day, which to my mind is his defining achievement and legacy. I don't want now to dwell at any length on what Roy's agenda would be in the crisis we face today. It's pretty clear that he would want to do now, to get us back into Europe and reverse Brexit, forge a Lib-Lab partnership capable of winning power from the centre-left, and carry through another burst of liberal modernisation. On Brexit, let me just say that I've not a shadow of doubt that faced with a bare-bones Johnson deal in a week or two, Roy would vote against it, on its merits, arguing that the immediate alternative is remaining in the customs union and much of the single market as possible, which was the basis on which the leavers themselves proposed that we come out of the EU 4 years ago, but also to signal our determination to retake all, not just some, of the ground lost to Farage, Johnson, Corbyn, and the forces of reaction. One of Roy's sayings was that in politics as in life, when things are going badly, they generally go worse than you expect. But when things are going well, they generally go better than you expect. So never fall prey to excessive gloom, but seize the moment. The fatalism and defeatism which pervade Labour, the Lib Dems, and progressive politics after the defeats of the last decade are a function above all of poor leadership. In the remainder of this lecture, I want therefore to concentrate on the Jenkins method for seizing the political initiative, for it's in his method, as much as in his values and policies, that I believe he has so much to teach us today. In his liberal convictions, Roy wasn't a great innovator, although he was a great lighthouse. Rather, his genius lay in turning conviction into actions and institutions of lasting effect. The legalization of homosexuality and abortion, the creation of the euro, the creation of the SDP, which presaged New Labour, are together more than most prime ministers have ever achieved. So let me now seek to illuminate the Jenkins method. First, the great liberal reforms. Here is Roy on his liberalising mission.
I have a high...
our social and sexual laws.
My basic position is a libertarian position, the view that the onus of proof is always very much on those who want to restrict the liberty of the individual. My basic position remains, and I hope that I can give some effect to that position as Home Secretary.
At the age of 45, Jenkins was one of the youngest ever Home Secretaries. He set about changing the moral framework of our society as the 60s swung. Abortion and homosexuality were legalised. Divorce was made easier. And theatre censorship abolished altogether.
I was trying to make Britain a more liberal and open society. Because I had always lived in a repressive climate in which the state tried to interfere too much in people's legitimate liberties and private lives. If you want to stop people doing something which they enjoy doing, which they believe is within their liberty of action, then you've got to have an overwhelming social case. Of course, I don't believe in people going around and doing things which do a great deal of damage to other people. But you have to, if you're going to stop them, you shouldn't do it out of prejudice or out of habit, but only because you can show that a definite social evil results from their private conduct. I believe private conduct broadly should be a private matter.
While Jenkins preferred to talk of a civilized rather than a permissive society, He was accused of creating a monster that was amoral and out of control.
What Mr. Tibbet, Mrs. Thatcher used to do from time to time, used to fulminate against the evils which I was alleged to have introduced in the 60s and to blame this for nearly all the ills of modern day society. What I noticed is that though they were both part of governments, indeed Mrs. Thatcher, the head of a government, with great majorities in the House of Commons for over a decade, but not a single one of the reforms of the 1960s, which they've expunged from the statute book.
It's an astonishing fact that Roy was Home Secretary for only 1 year and 11 months, from December 1965 to November 1967, and those 23 months included the 1966 general election. But in those 23 months, he radically changed the face of English society for the better. Before Roy, thousands of gays were prosecuted each year for their identity, and many were sent to jail. Illegal abortions were running at anything up to 200,000 a year. Hundreds of women died each year from criminal abortions in the most horrendous circumstances. Before Roy, bill after bill had failed in the previous 20 years to legalise abortion, while on homosexuality, there had been no progress whatsoever since the Wolfenden report 9 years earlier. Only months before Roy became Home Secretary, a private member's bill to legalise homosexuality was defeated outright on a free vote on the floor of the House of Commons after Labour had come to office, with Labour whips organising against it because, as Richard Crossman recorded in his diary, they, quote, objected fiercely that it was turning our working class support against us. A 1960s version of populist fears about the loss of the Red Wall. Roy's predecessor, Frank Soskiss, wouldn't even countenance a law against racial discrimination, arguing that this might stir up racial prejudice. Instead, he proposed a royal commission, knowing, as Harold Wilson said of royal commissions, that they take minutes and last years. And lest there be any sense of inevitability about what happened, when Roy enacted his liberal reforms in England, Willie Ross, Wilson's reactionary Secretary of State for Scotland, stopped homosexuality being legalised in Scotland for another 13 years. For a decade after 1967, French women came to England in their thousands for abortions each year because they still weren't legal in France. Ireland didn't legalise homosexuality until 1993, 36 years after the Jenkins reforms, and abortion not until 2 years ago, half a century after England. The first key to success is that Roy knew exactly what he wanted to do from the moment he became Home Secretary. More, he was passionate about it, and his passion was infectious, as you just saw. Jonathan Friedland once remarked insightfully that people don't believe in ideas, they believe in people who believe in ideas. That was certainly true of Roy. He was especially popular amongst the large and young intake of new Labour MPs in Wilson's 1966 Labour landslide, who were looking for a leader and a cause. As David Marquand, one of these self-styled Jenkinsites, put it, "It is hard to recapture in retrospect the sheer excitement Roy generated as Home Secretary." Whether left or right in Labour terms, Labour MPs saw Jenkins as a dynamic force and a face of the future. The second key to success is that Roy got an immediate grip of the notoriously conservative and gloomy Home Office. His first act was to change his permanent secretary after bitter exchanges about Roy's desire to take advice from junior officials who were better informed and more receptive to his reforms. He was also one of the first ministers to use special advisers effectively. In the week after Cummings, I simply say that Roy's special advisers acted as his agents and not vice versa. And they worked pretty effectively with the civil service machine, not against it. His longest serving special adviser, John Harris, was a smart former journalist and press aide to both Gaitskell and Wilson, who represented his boss so faithfully that he came to speak like Roy, gesticulate like Roy, think like Roy, smoke and drink like Roy, even to look like Roy. When I first met him, in the Reform Club, of course, I momentarily thought he was Roy. The third success Roy engendered was that he was himself a highly adept media operator. David Astor, editor proprietor of The Observer, wasn't just an admirer, he was a friend and hired Roy before the 1964 general election as a feature writer, giving him far greater prominence than he would have got as a mid-ranking opposition spokesman. Indeed, it was Observer features he wrote on aviation, which are why Wilson made him Minister of Aviation in 1964. Roy and John Harris also intensively cultivated Hugh Cudlip's Mirror, The Times under William Rees-Mogg, and The Economist under Alastair Burnett. On the right of centre, Roy was admired more as a moderniser than a liberal, and therein lies a fourth key facet of the Jenkins method. Roy ran his liberal reforms alongside a radical modernisation of the criminal justice system, which few doubted was long overdue. Two modernisations in particular he carried through: a rationalisation of police authorities, reducing the number from 117 to 49, the position we still have today, and the introduction of majority verdicts in trials, a controversial reform. Margaret Thatcher voted against it as an offence against the jury system, but one long overdue, and which Roy took pleasure in noting contributed more to the conviction of professional and dangerous criminals than any of the measures introduced by Margaret Thatcher's four Home Secretaries. William Rees-Mogg, ex-Balliol and father of you-know-who, wasn't remotely liberal, yet he was one of Roy's strongest supporters out of admiration for his sheer competence, dynamism, and political centrism, which were then held to be Balliol qualities and were then prized by the Times. Equally vital was Roy's parliamentary skill. He invested an inordinate amount of time in set-piece speeches. His greatest parliamentary test as Home Secretary was after the escape of the Russian spy George Blake from Wormwood Scrubs. Ted Heath tabled a censure motion, and in a debate of high drama, Roy trounced Heath and Quentin Hailsham, the Shadow Home Secretary, by demonstrating in forensic detail that everything he had done and not done in dealing with prison security, his Tory predecessors had done and not done worse. Crossman described it as a tremendous annihilating attack which completely destroyed the opposition. All of this, Roy's command of the Home Office, of Labour MPs, of the media and of Parliament, gave him the political capital to move on his liberal reforms. Without them, he couldn't conceivably have succeeded, since he had to carry radical reform in the face not only of deeply hostile public opinion, in the case of legalising homosexuality, and in the face of strong opposition from the leaders of all the churches in the case of abortion, but he also had a serious obstacle in the face of neutrality verging on opposition from the Prime Minister and the Cabinet. Wilson had reformist tendencies and admired Roy's sheer competence and panache, which is why he made him Chancellor when Callaghan collapsed over devaluation. But his constituency was heightened in the Catholic part of Liverpool, and his social liberalism, at least in public, didn't extend much beyond the Beatles. For this reason, Roy had to reform by means of an unusual and precarious device for such sweeping reforms: backbench private members' bills, which had to be carried through Parliament on free votes, with no government whip supplying. A critical factor in enabling Roy to succeed was his own extensive parliamentary experience as an MP already for 20 years by the time he became Home Secretary. He knew the private members' world back to front because in the late 1950s, he had used it himself to abolish print censorship. In 1959, after years of literary and parliamentary agitation, Roy had successfully piloted a private members' bill to allow a defence of literary merit in publishing books containing explicit sex. In legal terms, it was a half measure, for it still allowed censorship on grounds of obscenity, but it was the best he could get in a deal with the then Tory Home Secretary, Rab Butler. And without Rab's support, there was no chance of getting any reform through. In the event, its effect was practically to end censorship, largely because Roy himself persuaded the jury in the famous Lady Chatterley's Lover trial, which followed the passage of the bill, that Penguin should be allowed to publish D.H. Lawrence's then scandalous novel. This was the occasion that the prosecution counsel famously asked the jury, "Would you approve of your young sons and young daughters, because girls can read as well as boys, reading this book? Is it a book that you would have lying around in your house? Is it a book that you would even wish your wife or your servants to read?" This was the 1950s and 1960s, which weren't particularly swinging in most parts of the country. Roy applied his Lady Chatterley experience to the legalisation of homosexuality and abortion, carefully selecting backbench MPs, David Steele in the case of abortion, Leo Absey in the case of homosexuality, to promote the bills, then giving them full Home Office support, including in the drafting of the bills, even while the government itself was officially neutral, which was quite an act to carry off. Roy then persuaded Wilson and the cabinet first to agree that despite official government neutrality, he should be allowed to speak and vote for the bills, and other ministers should be allowed to vote for them too. And then, as was inevitably going to happen when the opponents attempted to filibuster the bills on the floor of the House of Commons, because there was no guillotine motion to limit debate, he persuaded the cabinet that additional government time should be made available for them. This led to a major cabinet row, but Roy made it a matter of confidence in himself, and Wilson supported him in giving this extra parliamentary time. Wilson needed his Home Secretary to be a success, and part of Roy's skill vis-a-vis Wilson was that he was generally a team player whilst also being a highly successful sole trader. On top of all this, Roy's timing and tactics were impeccable. He moved immediately after the 1966 election, not just on one, but on both legalisations, abortion and homosexuality. This obviously increased the controversy and hazard. Some of the leading parliamentary supporters of legalising homosexuality were opposed on abortion, including Shirley Williams, an observant Catholic, and vice versa. It involved, as Roy put it, treating the same MPs as heroes and hobgoblins on different days, while retaining their goodwill. However, his judgment was that he had a very narrow window of opportunity to mobilise on the run immediately after the 1966 influx of new and mostly Liberal Labour MPs. The fact that they saw these reforms as part of a whole Liberal programme, including Roy's other measures of abolishing flogging in prisons, ending theatre censorship and introducing the first race discrimination legislation, made them more, not less, supportive. And this judgment was vindicated. Both bills passed in the 1966-67 session, thanks to strong backbench Labour support for both of them. If Roy had phased the reforms, only one would have passed, and maybe not even one. By the second parliamentary session after the 1966 election, Roy was no longer Home Secretary. That latter-day John Bull, Jim Callaghan, was in his place, who declared, we've had too much sex on arriving in the Home Office. And by then, glad, confident morning was also receding fast on the Labour backbenches. I said a moment ago that Roy got the cabinet to agree he could speak and vote for the two bills. He spoke strongly in support of both bills at every stage in the Commons. On the second reading of the abortion bill, he described the status quo as harsh and archaic and in urgent need of reform. On the sexual offences bill, he didn't hide behind arguments about enforcement and police corruption. He stated boldly that homosexuality was a fact of life, not a matter of choice. It is, and I quote, not concentrated in any particular social classes or occupational groups. The majority of homosexuals are ordinary citizens who do normal jobs, and they deserve legal protection, not legal oppression. No Home Secretary had ever spoken like that from the dispatch box. It took three all-night sittings to get the two bills through their final stages on the floor of the Commons. After months in committee, Roy was on the front bench throughout and voted in all 45 divisions on the two bills. The third all-night sitting on the abortion bill started at 10:15 in the evening on a Thursday and finished at noon on the following Friday. A mammoth filibuster was ended only when it became clear to the opponents that Roy had managed to keep enough MPs in the House by lunchtime on the Friday to enable it to sit through a second night and into Saturday, if necessary, to get the bill through, breaking the filibuster vote by vote. It was by these means that the sexual offences bill became law at the end of July 1967 and the abortion bill at the end of October, just 1 month before Roy ceased to be Home Secretary. And one footnote. I said that Roy voted in all 45 divisions on the two bills. Howard Wilson voted in precisely zero. Callaghan also in zero, Margaret Thatcher in one, and that one was one of the liberal ones. Between Roy's Home Secretaryship and his presidency of the European Commission lies a decade of huge activity and strife as Chancellor, Deputy Leader of the Labour Party and Home Secretary for a second time for another 2 years after the 1974 elections. I could say a huge amount about all this, but I want to proceed straight to Brussels in 1977, because this was the second of Roy's three truly transformational projects. Immediately on arriving in Brussels in January 1977, Roy spent his first month setting out, as at the Home Office, a bold, fulfillable purpose to advance his central liberal conviction. His objective was, as he put it, to give a stronger bone structure to the European community he'd campaigned so fervently for Britain to join for the previous 20 years. And his big, bold, but achievable step to do this was economic and monetary union. Here is Roy early on in Brussels.
Our aim, our constant aim, must be to preserve the lot of the ordinary citizen throughout the community and to make him or her feel that Europe is becoming a better place in which to live. We must combat the growing divergences in the economies of our member states. Not, of course, by weakening the strong, but by strengthening the weak. Above all, we must remember our underlying and continuing purposes. Our means are and have been economic. Our end remains, as it was from the beginning, political. It is to make a European Union committed to the principles of justice, of individual freedom, of intellectual integrity and social fairness. And this is the time, even in the teeth of difficulties, which certainly exist, for a new and decisive advance.
A new and decisive advance, characteristic Roy words in favour of a bold project towards what he regarded as another frontier of civilization, buttressing taking forward of the European Union. The idea of economic and monetary union itself was as old as the European ideal. Shelves in Brussels groaned with EMU proposals, most recently the Werner Report of 1970, whose status was akin to the Wolfenden Report when Roy became Home Secretary, very worthy, but nearly a decade old and unimplemented. Roy's coup, on the back of the ongoing economic turbulence caused by the oil price shock of 1973, was to focus Europe's leaders and institutions on the immediate creation of a no-frills scheme for fixed but flexible exchange rates within carefully predetermined bands to limit volatility, intended to lead on to a single currency thereafter, which is essentially what happened over the next 20 years, thanks to the start he gave it with the European Exchange Rate Mechanism, launched in March 1979. As ever with Roy, this was the coming together of vision, leadership, and what Gladstone called, of his career, a lifetime spent working the institutions. Although not a technical economist, any more than any other Balliol PPEist, Roy had a sufficient grasp of the concepts. More relevantly, he was steeped in experience as an ex-Chancellor of the Exchequer. From this, he had a good knowledge of international monetary institutions and cooperation. More particularly, he had forged it in partnership with both President Giscard of France and Chancellor Schmidt of Germany, his main interlocutors in the creation of the European monetary system, both of whom had been fellow finance ministers when he was chancellor from 1967 to 1970. Indeed, it was largely thanks to them that Roy became president of the commission in 1977. Roy also played with great skill the new institution of the European Council, the twice yearly meeting of EU heads of government, then only nine strong, and the increasingly influential European Parliament, just as he'd managed the cabinet and the House of Commons so successfully as Home Secretary and Chancellor. Roy's Florence speech of October 1977, a magisterial presentation of the case for his proposed European monetary system, was full of Jenkinsisms. Let us think of a long jumper. He starts with a rapid succession of steps, lengthens his stride, increases his momentum, and then makes his leap. We have to look before we leap and know where we are to land, but leap we eventually must. But he also set out a clear roadmap. In Roy's original conception, this included new fiscal powers for the European Commission. These were ditched to keep the plan politically acceptable, instead strengthening the Commissioner's regional funds. Roy's other trait, which we observed at the Home Office, came immediately into play, his kind of double or quits approach to carrying through big reforms. A big debate in Brussels when he arrived in 1977, after the 1974-5 democratic revolutions in Portugal and Spain, was whether the Iberian countries should be admitted soon into the community or whether monetary union was the more important immediate priority. Roy did both together, arguing that they were mutually reinforcing. The stronger and more vital the community, the more essential membership would be to Europe's new democracies, soon to include Greece, and only 8 years after Roy's presidency, the whole of Central and Eastern Europe. Thus, the European strategy of what came to be called widening and deepening was launched at the same time. And Roy lived with huge pride and satisfaction to see both the euro and the decision in principle to expand the European Union to embrace the whole continent of Europe would take place. The trouble is that one country refused to deepen, and ultimately Europe proved insufficiently wide even to embrace, and that was his native Britain. Significantly, from the outset of the Commission, Roy had a far closer and more productive relationship with Giscard and Schmidt than with Callaghan, Wilson's successor as Prime Minister in 1976. Indeed, another reason why Roy was in Brussels in the first place, rather than in London as Foreign Secretary, was because Callaghan refused to give him the Foreign Office because he was too pro-European. Callaghan determined to keep Sterling out of Roy's exchange rate mechanism, not from much grasp, let alone judgment of the economics, but essentially to strike a nationalist pose. This Callaghan-Jenkins rift, which extended to most political issues they confronted in their generation, except resistance to the sub-Marxist left, was of huge significance because it established the opt-out mentality which every British government from Callaghan onwards applied to almost every European initiative. But there was absolutely nothing preordained about this. On the contrary, back in February 1970, when Roy and Giscard were the British and French finance ministers, Roy had told Giscard that if Britain joined the community, a key reason for doing so would be to overcome the chronic monetary instability so harming the British economy. I do not want to reserve the monetary field from the community, and we are prepared to move far in this field, he told Giscard in 1970, and this was central to his thinking at the Commission. Furthermore, for all Callaghan's John Bull, aped by his new Foreign Secretary David Owen setting himself up as Plymouth's dashing Eurosceptic Francis Drake, there was no public demand to stay out of the ERM in the 1970s. On the contrary, the whole purpose of Harold Wilson's successful European referendum, held only 18 months before Roy went to Brussels, was to be at the heart of the full European community, rather than continuing in the outer ring of the European free trade area where Britain had previously languished. The big issues in British politics in the late 1970s were inflation and undemocratic trade union power. There was little or no controversy about the ERM outside the leader columns, nor was the then Tory opposition opposed to membership on principle. The ERM could easily have been sold to the British public for what it was, part of the solution to the very problems of instability and weakness overwhelming the British economy. But it was not to be. Callaghan opted out of the ERM as one of the last substantive acts of the Labour government before the 1979 election. And we now know how this play ended. A Eurosceptic Labour Prime Minister was followed by a Eurosceptic Tory Prime Minister. From the launch of the ERM onwards, Britain's membership of the EU was half in, half out, and it ended up wholly out. The key point is this happened primarily because of the leadership of Britain's leaders, not because of the nationalism of its people. Roy urged full participation at each and every stage, and he was right. Half in, half out was fool's gold right from the beginning. It was largely because Labour became so anti-European after the 1976 referendum that Roy moved to set up a new Social Democratic Party on his return to Britain. Significantly, he didn't vote in the 1979 election, and Jennifer voted Liberal. And he gave his Dimbleby lecture, which indicated the tentative roadmap to the SDP as early as November 1979. It was a reaction more to the defeatist do-nothing leadership of Callaghan than to Thatcher, who'd only just entered number 10 and had yet to radicalise to the right. Callaghan's ERM opt-out led under his successor, Michael Foot, to support for complete withdrawal from the European community only 5 years after the 1976 referendum. Roy had as little time for the temporising of Callaghan and Healey as he had for the extremism of Foot and Benn. Harold Wilson, significantly, he generally regarded more favourably. The thing about Harold's smoke and mirrors, he told me, is that they were genuinely clever, and after the show was over, you realised that he'd largely got to the right place without the other side quite realising. The problem is, while it was happening, I didn't always realise either, is what he said to me. Indeed, on the greatest missed opportunity of the Wilson premiership, the abandonment of Barbara Castle's in place of Strife trade union reforms in 1969, Wilson supported them more strongly than Roy, which he always acknowledged afterwards as a point against himself. Which brings me to the SDP. The first thing to say is that the speed and decisiveness with which Roy moved on the SDP was almost incredible, although it fits into a pattern which we've now seen as the Jenkins mode of action at the Home Office and the European Commission. Roy's last day as President of the European Commission was January the 19th, 1981. Just 6 days later, he, Shirley Williams, David Owen, and Bill Rogers, the Gang of Four, signed the Limehouse Declaration and set up the Council for Social Democracy. Just 2 months later, on March the 26th, the SDP was launched as a party. Just another 2 months later, on May the 29th, the Labour MP for Warrington stood down, creating a by-election in that northern town. After Shirley havered and then decided against contesting it, Roy, with no hesitation whatever, took the plunge, and after the most intensive election campaign he'd ever fought, on July the 16th, less than 6 months after leaving Brussels in all his pomp, came within 1,750 votes of winning. It was, as he said at the declaration, only his second electoral failure, yet his greatest success by far. Here is Roy on the day of the SDP's launch, complete with Brian Gould pretending to be a journalist.
Coming up to 9 a.m. in rain-swept central London. Here at the Connaught Rooms in Great Queen Street, the Gang of Four gather with supporters from the House of Commons and the House of Lords for the press conference to launch Britain's new political party. At that press conference for TVI, Lou Gardner.
It began with a scrum down. Kodak and Ilford, at least, have caused to bless the new party. Anticipation mounted as we waited for the photographers to finish their business. Beyond all that Japanese technology, was there perhaps a new convert smiling modestly into countless lens? But when the clicking had to stop, it was the familiar faces of the Gang of Four who sat before us, neutrals as the party colours of red and blue suggested in the war between socialists and Tories. First, we were introduced to the lads on the substitutes bench, the 10 Labour MPs and the solitary Tory who have made the great leap into the political unknown. The formalities completed, Roy Jenkins, the prince who came back from over the water in Brussels, spoke the first words on behalf of the brand new party.
It becomes the Social Democratic Party. It is the biggest break in the pattern of British politics for at least 60 years, for two generations.
There had been talk of a detailed policy statement, but instead we got a 12-point list of tasks for Social Democrats. Less of a policy, more a quick tour of the peaks of a familiar land.
And I've always been struck whenever I've been in Britain by the extent to which we shackle ourselves by the extent of our class system in Britain, and by the extent of the divisions that we live with in this country. For example, divisions...
There were no surprises. The Social Democrats are against pointless conflict, dogma and class hatred. With everything to gain by changing the voting system, they are very much in favour of proportional representation. Today they called for a consistent economic strategy, something described as a flexible incomes policy, and they pledged their support to a mixed economy.
Our country's in real trouble, and I think everybody knows it. They can see unemployment rising, and they can sense that we will not recover our economic strength.
Yet signs of delicate compromise were clear even in their short document. The state, we were told, should lean towards equality. But in the same breath, the Social Democrats warned that if the state leans too heavily, it could threaten individual liberty. Perhaps Mr. Brocklebank Fowler, conservative convert, had been making his presence felt. Real equality for women, a fair deal for all, whatever their colour, and a swift nod towards the environment, and the Social Democrats had said all they intended to say. It seems we will have to wait a little longer to know just how this better, more tolerant Britain is to be achieved.
We believe, and we attach great importance to this, that we can reconcile rather than tearing apart the nation and give Britain as a whole a renewed purpose and success in the future. I'm open to your questions.
Brian Gould for TVI Thames Television. Mr. Jenkins, you've been out of British politics for 4 years, and you've spent that time working for the common market, which is hardly the most popular institution in Britain today. Doesn't that mean that you're out of touch, and won't your common market connection make it difficult for you to be accepted back into British politics?
I don't know. That's for the British people to decide. I have not found, since returning, a great antipathy to the policies we've been expounding, or to the fact that I have been away doing an important job for the past 4 years. I've not found personal hostility. I found a lot of people come and listen to me speaking, whether they agree or not. As a matter of fact, they mostly do seem to agree at the present time. But we'll see for the future. But at any rate, I do not think that having done a public service job outside Britain for 4 years, ought in the integrated world in which we inevitably live at the present time, to disqualify one from playing a part in British politics in the future, as I have done in the past.
That was the launch of the SDP. Summer 1981 saw the SDP soar to 50% in the polls. Shirley won the Crosby by-election on November the 26th. Just a month later, Roy took the by-election plunge for the second time in a year in Glasgow Hill Head, territory at least as hazardous as Warrington. He won it by 2,000 votes on the 25th of March 1982, a spectacular turnaround in a seat where the Liberals had previously been nowhere. It was almost a year to the day since the formation of the SDP. Back in Parliament, Roy was elected first leader of the SDP on July the 7th, 1982, and led the SDP Liberal Alliance into the 1983 election. We all know the upshot, a decisive advance for the new third force, but only 23 seats, and a split opposition, which saw Margaret Thatcher, the Boadicea of the Falklands, win a landslide of seats. Sensing that all he could do as leader was done, he immediately resigned, and the leadership of the SDP passed to David Owen. The key point, though, coming back to the Roy Jenkins method, is that his foundation and leadership of the SDP occupied just 29 months, about the duration of his formative leadership as Home Secretary, Chancellor, and President of the European Commission. Roy was only actually leader of the SDP for 341 days. Only one other leader of a British party has achieved so much in 341 days. Nigel Farage, with his last Brexit party, dedicated to reversing all that Roy himself had achieved in Europe in the previous generation. Imitation, flattery, but also surely the greatest exhibition possible that today we need another Roy Jenkins. Roy never looked back with acrimony. He said in the end of his memoirs, and he said to me frequently, that the only person he had genuine animosity to by the end of his life was David Owen. After the SDP, he went on to write his two greatest books, Gladstone and Churchill, to act as friend and mentor of the dominant Social Democratic leader since Harold Wilson in Tony Blair, and to emulate the best of Proust. And the judgment of history, or at least this historian, on Roy's centenary? Well, at the end of his life of Herbert Henry Asquith, Roy cites the inscription on the Westminster Abbey tablet to the fateful Liberal Prime Minister who took Britain into the First World War. It's from Milton's Paradise Lost. Unshaken, unseduced, unterrified, his loyalty he kept, his love, his zeal, nor number, nor example with him wrought to swerve from truth or change his constant mind. They are a fitting epitaph to Roy Jenkins himself. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andrew. Wow, there you go. Somebody, our great friend, Captain Aitken from the Royal Navy on Twitter has put insightful and thought-provoking. I think the phrase I'm searching for is subject matter expert, comprehensive and coherent. There you go. Okay. Let's turn to some questions. First is a comment from Tom Robinson up in Manchester, who says, please pass on my hearty approval of Andrew's grand old man picture. So that's the first one, okay? First question, Lord Liddell, who wrote in earlier today. Did Roy always get it right? Do you believe he thought his resignation as Labour's deputy leader in 1972 had been a mistake, when the issue at stake was not membership of the European community, but Wilson's commitment to a referendum on membership? And Jenkins went on to join the 1974 government that was committed to a referendum that Jenkins then played a key part in winning. Didn't this misjudgment fatally weaken his position in Labour for no real gain?
Well, that's a very good question, because Roy himself, at the end of his life, thought that the biggest mistake he thought he might have made, he said he wasn't sure, was resigning as Labour's deputy leader. By resigning as Labour's deputy leader in 1972, he weakens his position for 1974, when he could easily have become Chancellor if he'd been deputy leader. Indeed, probably would have been Chancellor. And if he'd been Chancellor in 74, given that he would have managed things, because he wouldn't have allowed such a big expansion to take place from 74 to 76. So he wouldn't have had the scale of the crisis in 76, the IMF and all of that. His chances of becoming Prime Minister after Wilson would have been very good indeed. However, one of my golden rules of life is that whether you think it or not, Roy was usually right. And though at the time, I thought that he was wrong, and even he thought he might have made a mistake. The issue on which he resigned, which, as Roger has just said, was the referendum, not Europe itself, that looks remarkably different now in retrospect. Roy's concern about the constitutional validity of the referendum and how it would work with parliamentary sovereignty, which in the 70s didn't appear to be an issue, because, of course, there was a 2-1 majority for backing up the decision that Parliament had already taken on membership of the European community. Seen from 2020, after the experience of 2016, maybe he was right.
Okay, next question from Matthew Lloyd, my old alma mater, Queen Mary. What do you believe Roy's advice would have been to Labour Party moderates during Corbynism? Andrew, while you've been speaking, Corbyn's been readmitted to the Labour Party. Would he have advocated leaving the party?
That's a tricky one, that one. Because, I thought all the time during the last 4 years, what would Roy have done now? And the problem was that you had a much worse takeover of the Labour Party by the left than ever took place in Roy's day. I mean, this is the equivalent of Tony Benn winning the leadership of the party in 1980-81, as opposed to not even winning the deputy leadership, which is what happened by hair's breadth when Denis Healy won it. However, there was a real existing crisis taking place at the same time in a hung parliament on the issue which Roy cared about most passionately, which was membership of the European Union. And the judgment I and many other people who I think are in this event this evening was that to split the Labour Party at the moment when only by United Labour Action was there any prospect whatsoever of stopping Brexit, would be a betrayal of the biggest objective of all. And the thing to do is to try and seize the situation to get Corbyn to move decisively in favour of a second referendum. Now, in retrospect, we know that that strategy failed. However, it's very hard to think that the strategy of splitting the Labour Party, you know, more comprehensively than happened with Change UK, was more likely to succeed. The fundamental problem was that the Social Democrats in the Labour Party never had a strategy for maintaining control and a vision of the future for the party and the country after Tony Blair. And Roy was always good at constantly painting a picture of the path which lay ahead. And it was the failure to do that after 2007, which lay at the root of all the problems that came thereafter.
Thank you. Robert Cho, ex of the OBR. With hindsight, did Roy feel, or do you feel, that he could have handled Callaghan better in delivering what he wanted on Europe in the 1970s?
Roy and Callaghan had a terrible relationship because both of them were vying essentially for the leadership of the party, and both of them massively distrusted each other's not only motives, but were actually much further apart in terms of their political objectives than might be thought by just lumping them together with this phrase, the Labour right, which is too often done by historians. In fact, their objectives were very, very different. Roy was a bold liberal reformer, whereas Callaghan was an old style Labour trade union deal maker who basically wanted to keep the status quo working with better deals for his members. So he was quite good on terms and conditions and issues to do with pay and straight living standards, but didn't share any of the wider liberal and pro-European objectives. Remember, it's Jim Callaghan who makes the famous language of Chaucer speech after the 1970 election, claiming that the language of Chaucer was at stake in any move towards joining the European community, and that what we should say to the French if they tried to make French the language of the community was non merci beaucoup, which was a great and decisive speech in moving Wilson against joining the European community, which he'd previously favoured, because what he feared was he was going to lose both the Labour left and the Labour right. Roy had utter contempt for that whole strategy, both its objectives and its means of achieving them. So maybe if they found a way of working more closely together, they might have been able to stem the rise of the left. But the problem was that Roy didn't even see Jim Callaghan as on the same page as himself. And I'm afraid, looking back at the history of what Callaghan did in his fairly disastrous stints of all the posts he held, Home Secretary, Chancellor, Foreign Secretary, and Prime Minister, I on balance agree with Roy. The only way this could have been done, I think, was by Roy himself becoming Wilson's successor as leader. The moment Callaghan became the successor, I don't think there was ever the makings of a partnership between them that would have worked.
Peter Hayden asks, democracy is everywhere under attack from populists and authoritarians. What do you think Roy Jenkins would today be advocating as the best means of defending liberal democracy?
He wouldn't be in favour of compromise. You see, the key thing about Roy is that having decided what his ground was and worked out that it was defensible ground, he was never in favour of ludicrous, quixotic gestures. He didn't flinch. He wouldn't have flinched for one moment before 2016 in making the passionate pro-European case. A good part of the reason why, as Peter and I know only so well because we've talked about this, why we lost in 2016 is that people who are supposedly in favour of staying in the European Union were never prepared to make the case for doing so. It was always, you know, the Cameroons and a half-hearted pragmatic defence of change being worse than the status quo, which were the arguments put forward. And of course, in Jeremy Corbyn, we didn't even have a leader who himself really believed in staying in the EU. What we lacked all the way through that referendum campaign was anyone with Roy's passion and vision and preparedness to make the case. You heard it in the clip just then, how he set out the whole, his whole vision of a Europe that worked closer together, that shared common values, and that didn't hark back to a violent past. He would have been making the passionate arguments for European cooperation and integration, which were just never made in 2016. And looking at what happened and how close the vote was, it's my view, if we'd made those passionate arguments, we would have won. Roy was never in favour of appeasing those who were fundamentally hostile and on the other side. He was every bit as tough as they were. He was a tough liberal, much tougher than you might have thought, given some of his other non-political interests. And it's this essential toughness and robustness in defending the liberal and social democratic cause, which was his abiding feature, as well as his decisiveness and ruthlessness at moving at the right time. And be absolutely frank, we've missed those badly in the last 10 years.
Andrew, we haven't got much time left, but we do have lots of questions. I'm just gonna take three, okay? Joseph Oliver asks, did you ever try to get Roy to rejoin Labour in the Blair years?
No. His view was that it would have been, as he put it to me, ludicrous, he said to me, ludicrous for me to change parties again at my stage of life. And he said, I'm also a close friend of Paddy Ashdown's and I never betray my friends.
Jeremy Clark asks, would Roy, with his view about private life being largely private, been able to survive in the current media climate where very little can be private?
I think Roy would have had any difficulty surviving because Roy was never a hypocrite. He never, this is one of his great and abiding qualities, is he never criticised other politicians for how they led their private lives. Indeed, he never even raised the issue of his opponents and their personal lives. Remember, in 1987, his opponent in Glasgow Hill Head was George Galloway, and he never made a thing at all of any of the many features of George Galloway's life, public and private, that he could have raised. He thought the politicians who did that were beneath contempt. And so my view is that he would have been fairly secure as well, because if the Daily Mail had tried to go, indeed his affairs were quite well known in his own political lifetime and had got some publicity, I don't think it would have made it much mileage, because there was never a scintilla of the hypocrite in Roy Jenkins, which is one of the characteristics that made him so attractive.
And a last question from Mohammed Kapal, I hope I pronounced that correctly. Can you identify a spiritual successor of Roy Jenkins in the Commons today?
No, I can't see one at the moment. But I keep looking, and let's hope, because if we don't have one, we've probably got the Tories in for another 10 years.
Andrew, thank you so much. I'm sorry to those who've asked questions, but we do need to draw it to a close.
And thank you, John, and thanks everyone. It's been a great experience. I'm very sorry about the division bells at the beginning.
No. I think they added particular, environment to us.
I'm really sorry, but Roy would absolutely have approved of that. That would have been a sign that my dedication to duty, as well as history.
Can I say, next week, the final one of the year, the final Strand Group of the year, we've got Lord Charles Moore. If Andrew's been talking about 100 years of Roy Jenkins, it's the 30th anniversary of the fall of Margaret Thatcher. But all that's left for me tonight is to say, Lord Adonis, I thought that was wonderful. This will be up on our website, as will the speech, so you can go back over it. I know I certainly will. It was certainly incredibly rich, and I think you did Roy proud. Andrew, thank you so much.